Today's reading comes from Romans, which is a letter from the Apostle Paul, who was extremely influential in early Christianity and founded many churches and visited many others. And here he is writing about an experience that probably most of us have had. So while I read what he says, ask yourself, yeah, I found myself in that same situation. So here it goes. This is from Romans chapter 7. For we know that the law is spiritual, but I am of the flesh, sold into slavery under sin. I do not understand my own actions, for I do not do what I want, but I do the very thing I hate. Now, if I do what I do not want, I agree that the law is good. But in fact, it is no longer I that do it, but sin that dwells within me. For I know that nothing good dwells within me, that is, in my flesh. I can will what is right, but I cannot do it. For I do not do the good I want, but the evil I do not want is what I do. Now, if I do what I do not want, it is no longer I that do it, but sin that dwells within me. So I find it to be a law that when I want to do what is good, evil lies close at hand. For I delight in the law of God in my inmost self, but I see in my members another law at war with the law of my mind, making me captive to the law of sin that dwells in my members. Wretched man that I am, who will rescue me from this body of death? Thanks be to God through Jesus Christ our Lord. So then, with my mind, I am a slave to the law of God, but with my flesh, I am a slave to the law of sin. We've all been there. We've all had to wrestle with that weaker self, that darker self that lives within us. We've all tried to keep that self under control. That self that is undisciplined, irresponsible, that self that may not be as compassionate as we would like to be, that self that gets us into trouble. If only we could keep that weaker self, that darker self, under control. I know it's true with me. There is more than one self living inside this mind. For example, when I have eaten a big meal and I'm very full, my full self says, I'm never going to do this again. I'm going on a diet. And I make that promise. My full self makes a promise that my hungry self will not keep. Because hours pass, and suddenly I'm thinking, I could go for something to eat. And then it starts all over again. That weaker part of us that is always kind of making life difficult. I think that it's a ritual in the South, and maybe here as well, but in the South, you have a mealtime ritual, and that involves eating way too much food, and then eating dessert, and then after that, as part of the ritual, then everybody says, oh, I shouldn't have eaten so much. I should have stopped before that piece of cake. And it's a ritual. They don't really mean it, and I know they don't really mean it because once I tried to interrupt that process. I was at Linda's house, and we were all sitting around the table, her and her four sisters and their husbands and all that stuff. And as usual, Patsy had made a lot of food, and we'd eaten a lot of food. And then people started saying, well, where's dessert? And Patsy started to go and get the cake that she had made. And I said, hang on, everybody, time out. If we stop right now, we won't have to say, oh, we shouldn't have eaten so much food. We won't have that regret. And her family looked at me like I had spoken blasphemy. Because I learned that that's not real regret. That's just a part of the ritual. You're supposed to say that, I shouldn't have eaten so much food. And so we all have that struggle within us. That weaker self, and your weaker self may be around some other issue. But we have the weaker part of ourselves, the darker part of ourselves, the part that sometimes gets loose, and we always regret it, And we always have to apologize for that darker self. This past week, I did something I had never done. I read the book, Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde. Now, I've heard of this story all my life, but turns out it's quite different than what I thought it was. I always thought that Jekyll and Hyde was the story of Dr. Jekyll, who then turned into this gross, big monster who stormed the streets. But that's not at all what it's about. It's about Dr. Jekyll, who is a good man, who's done a lot of good community service, who's well thought of in his community, a compassionate person. But he, too, is tired of struggling with his weaker self, his darker self, what Paul is talking about in this passage. And so Dr. Jekyll decides that there must be a way that he can free his noble self from that weaker, darker person. And so he concocts a potion, and he takes that potion, and when he takes that potion, he is able to transform from Dr. Jekyll, the noble and good, into Mr. Hyde. And Mr. Hyde is smaller than Dr. Jekyll. I didn't know that. But Mr. Hyde is smaller because Dr. Jekyll has spent his life trying to keep his dark side down and to keep it under control. So when he separates the two, Dr. Jekyll is his normal size, but Mr. Hyde is very small. And Mr. Hyde can then go out and do cruel things and be unkind and just a terrible person. And Dr. Jekyll hoped that when he turned into Hyde, he could do those bad things, and then when he turned back into Jekyll, he could just do good things, and he wouldn't feel guilty about what Hyde had done. And it's a very fascinating story, because as you read, the Hyde personality gets stronger and stronger, and it doesn't end well for Dr. Jekyll. Now, I won't say any more, because if you haven't read it, I encourage you to read it. Now's the perfect time of year to read Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde. It'll get you into the Halloween spirit. And a similar theme is found in stories about werewolves. Now, we looked at a couple of weeks ago at the power of ghost stories. And the power of ghost stories may be that we have strong love and attachment for people who then pass away, and we cannot let them go. And so ghost stories are part of what is born out of our inability to let people go. Or perhaps an injustice that has happened in the world that was never righted in life. A ghost story reminds us of that injustice. So there's power in ghost stories. And then last week we looked at vampires, and we thought that the power of the vampire story is rooted in our own fear of death and decay. And today we're looking at werewolves. And I think the werewolf story, the power of the werewolf story, is that it reminds us of the conflict within, of the beast within each of us. That's what Paul is wrestling with in Romans, that dark part of who we are, that sometimes leaps out, full moon or no, sometimes comes out and betrays us. Werewolf stories are about the evil within. You may remember that the story of Little Red Riding Hood. Sometimes werewolves aren't werewolves, they're just wolves in fairy tales. And Little Red Riding Hood, she encounters the wolf, and she meets the wolf not in some strange and frightening place. She meets the wolf at her grandmother's house. Because evil and the dark part of who we are comes from the familiar. Now, we don't like that. We don't like to admit that there's darkness within ourselves. We would rather it be outside. And maybe that's why the wolf in the story of the three little pigs comes from the outside. And the three little pigs try everything they can to keep the darkness from getting in. So one builds a house of straw, the other builds a house of sticks, and the third one builds a house made out of brick. And don't we do the same things with our security systems and arming ourselves to the teeth because we are convinced that the evil is on the outside? When in truth, the darkness is within all of us. And that is what Paul is talking about. Now, I know we don't like that. We would rather have our Westerns like good old John Wayne Westerns, where the good guys had white hats and the bad guys had black hats. But the truth of the matter is, life is more like a Clint Eastwood Western, where the good guys in white hats sometimes do unspeakably cruel things, and the bad guys in black hats sometimes save the town. That we're a mixture of these things. There's not pure good and pure evil. We're all in it. I was reminded the other day of Harry Potter, because I've mentioned Harry Potter before. I like Harry Potter. And there was a scene in Harry Potter that I'm going to share with you where Harry is worried that he's turning bad. And so he's talking to his godfather named Sirius. And so it kind of gets at what I'm trying to say. Here it is.
Where did you go?
Your dad's. He was always welcome at the Potter's. I see him so much in you, Harry. You are so very much alike.
I'm not so sure. Sirius, when I saw Mr. Weasley attacked, I wasn't just watching. I was the snake. And afterwards in Dumbledore's office, there was a moment when I wanted to... This connection between me and Voldemort, what if the reason for it is that I am becoming more like him? I just feel so angry all the time. And what if after everything that I've been through, something's gone wrong inside me? What if I'm becoming bad?
I want you to listen to me very carefully, Harry. You're not a bad person. You're a very good person who bad things have happened to. You understand? Besides, the world isn't split into good people and death eaters. We've all got both light and dark inside of us. What matters is the part we choose to act on. That's who we really are.
Harry, time to go.
So sometimes it is tempting to believe that the world is divided between good people and bad people. But the truth of the matter is, it is all inside us. You may remember, I told this story a few years ago. It's the story of the woman with the cookies. She went to the airport to catch a flight, and she had to wait for her flight, so she bought a bag of cookies at the snack shop, and she went and sat down next to a man that she did not know. And before long, she was surprised to see that that man reached over and took some cookies out of her bag. And she was absolutely revolted at this idea. You can go ahead and turn the lights on. And she just couldn't believe that he would do this. And so after a while, she reached in the bag of cookies and took a cookie. And he glared at her, and she glared at him. And this went on for quite some time, each one of them taking a cookie and glaring at the other one. Finally, her flight was called, and she got onto the plane, and she got her seat, and she opened her purse, and there inside the purse was the bag of cookies that she had bought at the snack shop. So what that reminds us of is that sometimes evil is in the eye of the beholder, and just when we are surely convinced that the other one is pure evil, the other one is convinced that you are. And so evil and good are much more mixed together than we might like to think. And I think it's true what Sirius said. It's our actions that determine who we are. Because each of us has the capacity to be a blessing or a curse. Each one of us has a chance to be a blessing or a curse. This past week, I got a phone call in the office. And I have to tell you that we get a lot of phone calls in the office from people who are not a part of our church, who have never been here, but who maybe they're a part in the community, or maybe they're passing through town. And we get a lot of strange requests, and I confess that most of them are things that we just don't even consider doing. And you never know the kind of person who calls into the church. And so we got a call from a family requesting a baptism for a family member who was near death. And I got that request, and I thought, oh, gosh, what is this going to be about? Typically, we don't do those kinds of baptisms because baptism happens within a community of faith, and it's not just an individual. It's about the community, and it's about what God has done. And so I really struggled. What should I do about this baptism? Plus, you know, it was somebody who has lived near here but never come to this church and never participated in anything, has no ties to us whatsoever, and now they want a baptism. And so I have to tell you, part of me was like, I just don't want to do this. And then a family member came by the office to request it again, and so we talked, and I was like, ugh. I could feel the weaker part of me, the darker part of me, like, well, they have no ties to this church. I don't want to go do this. But I finally decided that I would go do it. And I drove to Center Point where this person was and, you know, wasn't happy about doing it. There's nothing worse than a begrudging baptism. But anyway, I had my baptismal stuff. And I went out there, and there was the family and this person, and it turned out to be a beautiful experience. And it was something that brightened my day, and it was a blessing to me that I got to do this for this person and for this family, and to remind them that God's grace was there with them, and that it didn't matter whether they had been a part of the church, and didn't matter all those things that my worst part was worried over, and it turned out to be something that just transformed my entire day. It's just such a narrow tightrope. The cursed side of me could have won out, but I'm just so fortunate that on that particular day, the blessing side won out, and it was a great experience. Yesterday, Will was selling popcorn for the Scouts at Fred Meyer, and I'm sure some of you have been tried to be sold to. And a man came up and said, I will buy 5 beef jerky sticks from you if you will go and give them to that homeless man. Now, we have all seen people who, whether they're homeless, usually they're homeless standing out near the red light with a poster that says, please help, or something like that. And we all have a variety of attitudes about those people and what has led them to that state. And we have a variety of attitudes about whether or not we're going to help them or not. And I have all the same red flags that you do. But this man said, I will buy these 5 beef jerky sticks if you will go and take them and give them to this poor man. And so Linda and Will said, okay. And so he bought the sticks. And then Linda and Will walked over to where the homeless man was. And Will was wearing his scouting uniform. And when they presented the 5 sticks to the homeless man, the homeless man stood up and saluted. Now that's an opportunity where our weaker selves, our darker selves, our more suspicious selves could have said, oh no, we're not doing that. But just by the narrowest of margins and the slimmest of chances, on that particular occasion, the blessing side came out. And it turned into a blessing not only for this unknown man, but also for Will and for Linda. And so blessings are so important. That's why we have the blessing wall. That's why we encourage you to participate in our blessing program. The song that started our worship service this morning is called MLK, and it's by U2. And it's also a blessing song. It was a song that Bono wrote as an act of blessing for Martin Luther King. Because Martin Luther King also had to face down werewolves. He had to face down the beast that was raging within white Southern America that absolutely hated him and everything he stood for and black people and wanted to keep them in their place. And he had to face them. And he had to face the beast within his own people who had been wronged for so many years and who wanted to scratch out and lash out. And he had to hold all that together and overcome it and not give in to violence, not give in to the wolf that dwells within us all. And he was remarkably successful at that. And we see people being successful at that all the time. Right now in Chicago, there's a group called Cease Fire that is working in communities where there's a lot of gun activity. And they're working in such a way as to change the culture so that it's frowned upon to pull a gun and made to feel like, what a loser thing to do. And they've had tremendous impact on lowering the levels of gun violence. Overcoming violence, overcoming the wolves that are within us is part of the gospel. It's part of what Jesus was about, and it's what ultimately put Jesus on a cross, because the beast within, the rest of the people, could not abide the Prince of Peace. And so Bono wrote this song, and it is a blessing. It's kind of a lullaby meant for Martin Luther King. And part of it, the song says, let it rain down on him. And the him in the song is Jesus. And that is, you be comforted, Martin. You be comforted, all of you who would try to overcome violence and act out of your blessing selves and your better selves. All of you go with peace. And when the rain pours down, let it fall on Jesus, because that's what he was all about. I'd like to ask you to stand, and we're going to play that video again. I want to ask you to sing this song with me as our closing. Let us go forth from this place, choosing to act in our better selves, our blessing selves, and let us whisper our benediction. Ready?